So good morning everyone. Today we would be talking about ligase enzyme, alkaline phosphatase enzyme and polymerase enzymes. These are the different type of enzymes that take, play a very crucial role in the field of genetic engineering. In the previous lecture, we have talked about restriction endonucleases. That means restriction enzymes, what are their types and all. Now the main focus would be on to the further enzymes, that is ligase enzymes. We'll be getting to understand what is the ligation process, which enzyme is known as molecular glue, what are their different types, their different properties, their mechanism of action. Along with that, different DNA modifying enzymes, for example, alkaline phosphatase, polymerase enzymes, their types, and what is their mechanism of action. So that is our main part that we will be covering today. So starting with the introductory part, we all are very well aware of this fact that the cutting and pasting are one of the two main skills that kids learn when they are, when they are growing up in their, childhood. And most commonly used tools they use are scissors and glue, right? The kids use scissors and glue to perform various cutting and pasting activities. However, in the previous lecture, I also told this thing that genetic engineering, basically it is a cut and paste approach in which the scissor and glue is named as molecular scissor and molecular glue. Molecular scissor is restriction enzyme that we have already discussed. However, now the point is, what is a molecular glue? So similarly, in the cutting and pasting approach, cutting and pasting activities that kids perform, the similarly cutting DNA and pasting DNA fragments are typically the most common techniques that, we normally perform in the molecular biology laboratory. And that is the fundamental thing to the recombinant DNA work or genetic engineering work. As you can see, there is a comparative. This is the cutting and pasting activity that kids perform, and this is in the case of genetic engineering, in which if this is the DNA, first of all you need to cut it with the scissor, that is restriction enzyme, and these overhangs are generated known as sticky hangs. However, we have discussed these things previously also. Now some kind of manipulations enzymes and some kinds of, you can say, a complete toolkit of enzyme is used if you are going for any genetic engineering based experiment. In that case, first is restriction endonuclease. DNA ligase is the enzyme that act as a molecular glue. That means to join together the different DNA fragments. That work is done by DNA ligase, because it ligate the ends together, it join the pieces together, it join the pieces of DNA together. However, regarding these two enzymes, restriction enzyme and DNA ligase, there are variety of additional enzymes also that also help in, this various genetic engineering experiment and facilitate this process. This is the complete chart actually, because we are talking cutting, modifying and joining DNA. We require what kind of, what thing? We require enzymes. In that case, there are few catalytic protein molecules and they are purified from wide range of different cell types. You can say, for example, I told you that restriction enzymes, they are purified from bacteria, because bacteria use this as their defense mechanism to provide them protection against various kinds of infections or viral infections. So these DNA modifying enzymes, these kind of enzymes are basically categorized in three types: restriction endonuclease, which we have already discussed in detail. Next is DNA ligase, which we would be discussing today, and DNA modifying enzymes such as nucleases, polymerases, and enzymes that act on the termini. First of all, DNA ligase, as the name suggests, the main function is to join together the DNA molecule. It can do this thing either via phosphodiester linkage, and it will result in the generation of recombinant DNA by joining together the pieces of DNA. On the other hand, in case of DNA modifying enzyme, if you are talking about nucleases, as the name suggests, nucleases, that means such kind of enzymes that will act on the nucleic acids. Now the nucleic acids can be of two types, DNA and RNA. That means these enzymes can act on both DNA as well as RNA. However, there are further two types. One is endonuclease, another is exonuclease. As you can see it here also. Endonuclease and exonuclease. Now, endonucleases are those enzymes which have the capability to cut the DNA internally. That means such enzymes that can make internal cuts. That means within the DNA, they can make the cut. Those are known as endonucleases. For example, restriction endonucleases. Why we call it as restriction endonucleases? Because they make internal cuts. However, the other class is exonucleases. Exonucleases means those enzymes which will act on the terminus. You can say they will cut the DNA at the ends. Those are known as exonucleases. Now, there are few polymerase enzymes. Polymerase enzymes, they are known as DNA polymerase, clinofragment, reverse transcriptase enzymes. These are listed here. The main function is to carry out polymerization activity. That means to add the nucleotides to the DNA so that the complete new strand of DNA can be synthesized. That is the function of DNA polymerases. Now, there are few enzymes that act on the terminus of the DNA, such as alkaline phosphatase, polynucleotide kinase, terminal transferase. The main function is to that they will act on the terminus of the DNA and they will modify the DNA. That means they can add certain groups or they can remove certain groups. So those enzymes are known as DNA modifying enzymes. And the main basic activity is being performed by restriction endonucleases and ligases. All other enzymes are known as DNA modifying enzymes because they have the capability to modify the DNA by adding various kinds of groups into it. Now, DNA ligase. Apart from the cutting of DNA, the another important requirement was joining together of two DNA molecules or joining together of DNA fragments so that you can get a completely new recombinant DNA molecule. For this thing, DNA ligase enzyme was being used, and this enzyme was first of all isolated from E. coli. It is a bacteria which was infected with bacteriophage T4, because again, the bacteriophage T4 infected E. coli bacteria was able to produce this enzyme. In the beginning of 1967, there was a scientist named Martin Gallet. He first of all reported the formation of covalent circles of bacteriophage DNA by using this E. coli cell extract. From there, he inferred that there is something being produced by E. coli that is basically the linear bacteriophage genome. It is being circularized. It is being, changing its structure to a closed form. So at the end of 1967, some other research groups were also working in this area, and they isolated, at that time, this scientist, it isolated DNA ligase enzyme from E. coli. And they, reported that this is the enzyme that is responsible for joining together of different molecules. However, the main function, or you can say the main mechanism, is that they will repair the phosphodiester bonds. If, as you can see, that when we discussed about restriction endonucleases, at that time we showed that there are some sticky ends, there are some overhangs, and those overhangs, the phosphodiester bonding is broken. At that time, this DNA ligase enzyme basically act on that bond, and it will repair that bond. It will, retrieve that very phosphodiester bond so as to make a altogether new recombinant DNA molecule. You can say it will seal all kind of discontinuities or some kind of nicks that are happening in the sugar phosphate bond so as to repair the DNA or so as to produce the new recombinations of DNA. That is why we call it as molecular glue. That means its main function is to stick together the DNA pieces. And that is why it is being considered as main key enzyme in the genetic engineering. Now the point is, having talked about what is DNA ligase and what is its mechanism, that it is basically repairing phosphodiester bond. Now the point is, what are the types? There are three main types: bacteriophage T4 DNA ligase, E. coli DNA ligase, and tag DNA ligase. As you can see in this animation also, there is some break, and at that time, at that very place, the DNA ligase enzyme is basically, you know, it is being used as a glue so as to join together the pieces, or so as to seal that discontinuity. Now, talking about the different types, first is bacteriophage T4 DNA ligase. First of all, as the name suggests, from where it is isolated, what is the source? This enzyme is isolated from T4 bacteriophage infected E. coli. The main function it is being used rapidly in the various DNA ligation experiments. The main function is to catalyze the formation of phosphodiester bonds between 5' phosphate and 3' hydroxyl group of different DNA segments. They will be joined together by formation of a new phosphodiester bond. That means it is also helpful in repairing single strand nicks in the double stranded DNA. Suppose if there happens to be some sort of nick, for example, this is the double strand DNA and there is a nick. This blank space is known as nick. This nick can be repaired by this DNA ligase. It will seal this nick by making a new phosphodiester. The main application part of this very DNA ligase isolated from bacteriophage T4 infected E. coli is ligation of cohesive ends. Cohesive ends means sticky ends, staggered ends. Then it can also bring about the ligation of blunt end termini also. However, it can also bring about the ligation of synthetic linkers or adapters, because sometimes in the genetic engineering experiment, what happens is we are trying to ligate those pieces of DNA who are not having overhangs. For example, as you can see here, I'll draw a diagram here. Suppose these are the two DNA fragments. Now, as you can see, the ends are blunt here. There are no overhangs. In that case, how we can proceed for the ligation of this, because the ligation is only effective, it is highly effective if the pieces are having sticky ends, because the process is fast and the binding is quite efficient. In that case, in case of this blunt-ended termini, what happens is we specifically add some linkers or adapters, or you can say such kind of short stretches of DNA that is having some overhang. For example, if I, you know, paste a overhang here and there is, you know, two base pair unpaired are here. In that case, if I am pairing one overhang here and again two complementary base pairs are present here. So it is very easy for the DNA ligase enzyme to join together these two pieces as compared to the blunt end. So these short stretches of DNA, they are known as adapter molecules. Next is E. coli DNA ligase. Now, as the name suggests, the source is E. coli. It has been isolated simply from E. coli. It is not infected by any kind of virus. Main function is to catalyze the formation of phosphodiester bond in double-stranded DNA that is having some sticky ends or cohesive ends. However, in certain cases, they also catalyze blunt-end ligation also. But in that case, we need some, additional molecules. For example, you can use polyethylene glycol, that is PEG, so as to promote the ligation at a faster pace. Main application is, again, ligation of sticky ends and cloning of full-length cDNA. That means if you want to clone a different gene taken from one organism and you want to clone that very gene to altogether a different organism, either if you have isolated RNA, you can convert that thing to cDNA so as to have a full length clone and the most efficient clone. In that case also, we use DNA ligase isolated from E. coli. There is one more important point. In the most commonly used experiments in our laboratories also, we use this E. coli DNA ligase enzyme. Next is tag DNA ligase. Now, as you can see why I have written tag. This tag basically corresponds to the type of organism from which it was isolated. Here the T correspond to thermus and AQ correspond to aquaticus. It is a thermostable bacteria. From this thermostable bacteria, this tag DNA ligase enzyme was isolated. The main function is to catalyze the joining of nicks that are present in the double-stranded DNA, as I have shown in the previous slide also. However, they can also catalyze the blunt end ligation if the temperature is way higher. Because as I told you that this thermus aquaticus, it is a thermostable bacteria. That means this bacteria is stable at higher temperature or elevated temperature, say around 70 to 80 degrees Celsius. In that case, the sort of enzymes that are being isolated from these bacteria, they are also thermostable in nature. That means they can catalyze the ligation even if the temperature is way higher. In case of detection of various mutations in the different kind of organisms, in that case, we can use this tag DNA ligase enzyme. However, although the enzymes are most efficient, these DNA ligase enzymes are most efficient when they are sealing gaps in the fragments that are, you know, summed together, either held together by sticky hands. But it can also promoting the ligation of blunt-ended fragments also. If the appropriate conditions or agents or environmental conditions are provided. Most important part, most of the enzymes, they have their optimum working temperature, and that optimum working temperature is generally room temperature, that is 37 degrees Celsius. But if the temperature is lower, for example, say 4 to 15 degrees Celsius, to prevent thermal denaturation of short base pair fragments also, so that these cohesive pairs can be held together. That means the complete ability to cut, modify and join DNA molecules give a person who is working in this field to create recombinant DNA so as to achieve its, achieve altogether a unique property. Now, this DNA ligase, it is the most fast and it brings about the most fast and effective ligation of DNA and RNA. You can use different types, T4 DNA ligase and T4 RNA ligase. Now, why I have written DNA and why I have written RNA? Because this ligase will join together the DNA pieces. However, the T4 RNA ligase, it will join together the pieces of RNA. That is why it is named as T4 RNA ligase. Now, what is T4 DNA ligase? It will catalyze the formation of, again, phosphodiester bond between the 5' phosphate and 3' hydroxyl group of two different DNA fragments. In that case, this 5' phosphate and 3' hydroxyl group should be free. This enzyme will also repair the single strand breaks, or you can say the single strand nicks in the double-stranded DNA, in the RNA, or DNA hybrid. It will also join the DNA fragments either with sticky ends or with blunt ends. But single-stranded nucleic acids will not be able to, they can't be repaired by this very DNA ligase enzyme. However, this T4 DNA ligase enzyme, it requires sort of energy to bring about this function, because in that case, the ATP act as a cofactor. Next is T4 RNA ligase enzyme. This is an ATP-dependent intra- and intermolecular formation of phosphodiester bonds that is being triggered by this enzyme. Again, we need two free ends, that is 5' phosphate and 3' hydroxyl group. And it can work on single-stranded RNA and DNA both. Now, up to this, we have talked about only DNA ligase. Now, the next point is, what are DNA modifying enzymes that we were talking, that these enzymes can modify the DNA, they can add certain groups. So enzymes which are involved in the degradation, synthesis and modification of the nucleic acids, they fall under this category. And these enzymes are involved in bringing about different kind of modifications, in which the first enzyme is alkaline phosphatase, because the main function is to modify the ends of DNA molecule. The enzymes alkaline phosphatase, polynucleotide kinase, in which it is, the example is T4 polynucleotide kinase, and terminal transferase. All of these three enzymes, they act on the terminus of DNA. You can say the end of DNA molecule, so that various different combinations can be prepared. However, there are few other enzymes, for example, phosphatase and kinase. As the name suggests, they are either involved in the removal or addition of the phosphate group. As you know, phosphatase. So that means it will involve the phosphate group. Similarly, kinase, the main function is to add the phosphate group. So all of these enzymes are named as such. First enzyme is alkaline phosphate, in which the enzyme isolated from bacteria, it is known as bacterial alkaline phosphatase. However, there are other enzymes also that have been isolated from altogether different source. For example, calf intestinal alkaline phosphatase. Basic function is to remove the phosphate group from the 5' ends of the DNA. You must be thinking about this, that we are talking about, if you want to join two pieces of DNA, in that case you must have a free 5' phosphate. That phosphate group is basically removed by this alkaline phosphate. If that group is removed, that means you have modified the DNA. So alkaline phosphatase enzyme, from where it has been isolated, from bacteria, from calf, and from Arctic shrimp. So depending upon their source, they are named as such: bacterial alkaline phosphatase, calf, and Arctic shrimp. Main function is to remove the 5' phosphate groups from DNA and RNA. However, they can also act on 5' overhangs. Overhangs means sticky ends, or 5' recessed ends or blunt ends. So this is the function that why we use it. Sometimes what happens whenever we are performing some sort of genetic engineering experiment or recombinant DNA experiment. Suppose I am giving you a task that you isolate the human gene and you ligate that very gene by using a PBR322 vector and express that thing in the E. coli. In that case, you will take the human gene and you will ligate that thing in the vector. Ligation by DNA like this. But sometimes the ends are so complementary, or you can say whenever you cut the vector with these with the same restriction enzymes, as you can see, 5' phosphate group is there, here the hydroxyl group is there. Because of the complementary things, what happens is these vectors, they sometimes self-ligate. That means the gene is not inserted, but because of the complementary ends, they perform the self-ligation reaction by using the enzyme ligase. So as to prevent these things, what do? We remove these phosphate groups by using alkaline phosphatase. Now you see, you have used this enzyme, and here in at free ends, hydroxyl group is present. So whenever you are inserting your DNA insert, at that time insert would be there, but there would be a nick because we have removed the phosphate group. In that case, this nick may be further repaired by DNA ligase again, so that it can create the 5' phosphate group. Or you can use kinase enzyme so that the phosphate group can be inserted and phosphodiester bond can be prepared. So this is the main application part of this alkaline phosphatase, so as to have a full length cloned DNA, or so as to have an efficient cloning or efficient clone. So next enzyme is polymerase. As the name suggests, they are the enzymes that synthesize copies of nucleic acid. That means they have the polymerization activity. They are most commonly used in the genetic engineering experiments. If you want to synthesize complementary strands, if you have single stranded DNA, or you have double stranded DNA, or you want to generate more copies, in that case we use polymerase enzyme. However, whenever you describe a polymerase enzyme, there are few terms that we normally use. One is DNA dependent, another is RNA dependent. Why we are using these terms? DNA dependent means A DNA dependent polymerase means this enzyme is dependent on a DNA molecule. That means it will act on a DNA, or you can say the main template would be DNA. However, when we are quoting RNA dependent, that means the template would be RNA. You can't use this enzyme in the DNA based experiments. So a DNA dependent DNA polymerase enzyme, the main function is to copy DNA into DNA. That is why we call it as DNA dependent polymerase. RNA dependent DNA polymerase enzymes are those enzymes that copies RNA into DNA. The main function is to add the nucleotides. It will the final thing would be DNA, but the template they would be acting upon, that would be RNA. That is why it is named as RNA dependent. Then there is another sort of enzyme, that is DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. Now the template would be DNA, right? But enzyme name is RNA. That means the DNA would be converted into RNA. That means it will transcribe DNA into RNA. So these enzymes synthesize nucleic acid by joining together different nucleotide bases. Wherever the bases are complementary to the template strand, and the main synthesis, the direction of synthesis along with the replication fork, that is 5' to 3' direction. And whenever a particular nucleotide is added, they require a free 3' hydroxyl group so that a nucleotide can be added and a phosphodiester bond can be created and the nucleotide addition can be proceeded upon. Now they are the main copying enzymes. They are dependent upon the templates. You can use this enzyme to copy long stretches of DNA that we use in the PCR reactions also. So these are the types: DNA polymerase 1, clinofragment, T4 DNA polymerase, thermostable DNA polymerase, terminal deoxynucleotidyl transferase. So starting with the first, DNA polymerase enzyme. The source is E. coli. It has been isolated from a bacteria known as E. coli, and it is a template dependent DNA polymerase. It will catalyze the synthesis or polymerization in the 5' to 3' direction, and the DNTPs, or you can say the dinucleotide triphosphates, would be added at free 3' hydroxyl group by using DNA or RNA primer. However, this enzyme also exhibits the activity of 3' to 5' exonuclease activity. That is known as proofreading activity. Why we need this? Because what happens whenever the replication is going on, or you are carrying out, this enzyme is basically used in vivo conditions. In vivo conditions, when the DNA is being replicated, in that case this DNA polymerase enzyme is used. In that case, what happens, sometimes incorrect nucleotides are added. So, because of this proofreading activity, what happens is, if this DNA polymerase enzyme will goes back, will remove that that incorrect nucleotide, and again will synthesize the correct nucleotide. That is why we call it as proofreading activity. However, it also sometimes exhibit 5' to 3' exonuclease activity, but that thing needs to be removed. The main function is to fill the gaps in the double-stranded DNA that may arise. As you can see here, synthesis of second strand of DNA. You see, polymerase is moving. Some extra CAGs are added here. So if these things are there, or some nicks are generated, these things are repaired by this DNA polymerase enzyme. Or you can say, if you have labeled the DNA by nick translation, that is also being further carried upon by this DNA polymerase. Next is clinofragment. Clinofragment, basically it is a large fragment of DNA polymerase 1. That means this enzyme is derived from DNA polymerase 1. The source is DNA polymerase 1 enzyme would be treated with a protease known as septellicin. What it will do? It will remove the shorter segment, and a large fragment would be there. That large fragment is known as clinofragment. It will have 5' to 3' polymerase activity. That means it can add the nucleotides. It will have the 3' to 5' exonuclease activity. Why we call it as
proofreading activity?
Proofreading activity means whenever some sort of incorrect nucleotides are added. For example, suppose this is the strand, and here the bonds are being added. Bonds are added. Suppose at this position an incorrect nucleotide is added. If the incorrect nucleotide would be added, there would be no bond formation. So DNA polymerase is further, you know, carrying out the activity. But because it is having a proofreading activity, this normal polymerization is being proceeded in the direction 5 prime to 3. Wait. In the normal cases, this polymerization is being proceeded in 5 prime to 3 prime activity, 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Whenever there is an incorrect nucleotide, as I have shown in the previous slide also, this is the DNA polymerase working, but here it is added a loop because an incorrect nucleotide is added, or it is not able to recognize that at this place which nucleotide was to be added. So a loop would be created. If this loop is created, so what this DNA polymerase will do, it will goes back to this position at which this loop is created, and it will remove these loop by the 5 prime to 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity. That activity is known as proofreading activity. Why we call it as proofreading? Because it is again checking its proof that whether it has added the correct nucleotide or not. Because once it has added all the nucleotides, it will again go back and it will check that whether the nucleotides that I have added, whether it is correct or not. If this enzyme will find any kind of incorrection or any incorrect nucleotide is added, in that case it will remove that nucleotide because of the proofreading activity, because its general direction of movement is this 5 prime to 3 prime. But for the proofreading, it has to go back. It will goes back and it will check that whether an incorrect nucleotide is there or not. If it would be there, it will repair that thing automatically. It need not to have some another sort of mechanism to correct it. I'm moving further. So the main clinofragment function is it would be having polymerization activity and proofreading activity. That is must whenever you are carrying out any kind of genetic engineering or RDT based experiment. As you can see how it was generated, this is the DNA polymerase 1 enzyme. There are different domains. This is a polymerase domain. That means it is having the activity of 5 prime to 3 prime polymerization. This is the domain of 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease domain. We don't need that. That is why what we do, we want to have these two domains. So with the help of a protease enzyme, we remove this very domain, this blue color domain. So the 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease domain is removed, and this large fragment that is having a polymerase activity and proofreading activity, that is retrieved, and that is known as clinofragment. So it is used when a single-stranded DNA molecules need to be copied. In that case, we use this clinofragment because we have removed the shorter segment of 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease. That is why we call it as DNA polymerase and proofreading enzymes. And it is most commonly used enzyme in the molecular biology based experiments. These are the few applications of it. Synthesis of double-stranded DNA, if you want to fill up the recessed ends, or if you want to repair the nicks, if you want to, prepare the primers that are labeled with radioactive agents, if you want to go for some in vitro mutagenesis experiments also. However, although all those things would be coming in our next lectures also, that how we can use this enzyme in that very experiment. But right now the applications are listed. This is the synthesis of double-stranded DNA from single-stranded template. As you can see, this is the template DNA. This is the primer. Clinofragment is added because it would be having a proofreading activity and DNA polymerization activity. These are the four DNTPs: adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine. It is adding the complementary strand in this direction. Next is T4 DNA polymerase. As the name suggests, it is isolated from T4 bacteriophage. It is a template dependent DNA polymerase and it will again catalyze the 5 prime to 3 prime synthesis. However, this enzyme is not having 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity. That means it is not having proofreading activity, but its processivity is very higher. Processivity means the number of nucleotides that this enzyme can add per second. As you can see, it has high processivity. That means in 1 second, it can add 400 nucleotides. The main highlights are stronger 3' to 5' exonuclease activity. Processivity is way higher as compared to the normal conventional DNA polymerase enzyme. That is why we use this enzyme in various PCR reactions, RT reactions, or some DNA ligase-based buffers also. These are the few applications. That is blunting of DNA and filling in of 5' overhangs. We can, basically go for the synthesis of labeled DNA prop. If you want to label some ends, some sticky ends, that thing also can be done with this enzyme. T7 DNA polymerase, as the name suggests, T7. That means it is isolated from E. coli that is infected with T7 bacteriophage. Again, it is a template dependent. It will catalyze the synthesis in, again, 5' to 3' reaction. And it is also having high processivity. That means the number of nucleotides to be added per second. However, it also exhibits a strong 3' to 5' exonuclease activity. That is a proofreading activity. The main highlights, because I am talking it as that this is having a strong proofreading activity, this one, it is 1,000-fold greater than the Cleno fragment that we have talked about. That means its proofreading activity, its proofreading mechanism is very well equipped. It can detect the incorrect nucleotide within, you can say, in fraction of nanoseconds. Next is thermostable DNA polymerase. As the name suggests, it has been isolated from a thermostable bacteria, or you can say hyperthermophilic bacteria, for example, Thermus aquaticus. The main function is, again, template-directed DNA synthesis from a free 3' hydroxyl group. We normally use this thermostable DNA polymerase in PCR reaction, for example, TAC DNA polymerase. Last is terminal deoxynucleotidyl transferase. In the case of at the terminal end, we need to remove or we need to transfer some deoxynucleotide residues. In that case, we use this enzyme. This has been commercially purified from E. coli cell that is expressing a thymus gene. It can add a particular nucleotide to 3' end of DNA. However, it is not template dependent. It do not require any kind of template to carry out this function. The preferred substrate is 3' overhang, that means sticky end. These are the few applications. We can do this thing by homopolymer tailing or probe preparation. These are the tailing part that, as you can see, their tails are created at both the ends by adding same kind of group. Last is RNA polymerase, E. coli RNA polymerase. It is a multi-subunit enzyme of E. coli. DNA-dependent RNA polymerase is there. It can make copy of RNA, RNA copy of DNA or RNA. Next is bacteriophage. As the name suggests, it has been isolated from a bacteriophage that is infected with some, that have infected some sort of bacteria, and it can further produce a purified recombinant protein. Main function, DNA-dependent RNA polymerization activity, and it can catalyze the 5' to 3' synthesis of RNA using either single-stranded DNA or double-stranded DNA template. You can use this thing for synthesis of single-strand RNA transcript and expression of clone gene in the bacteria. In various RNAs protection assay also, we use this enzyme. Poly-A polymerase enzyme, as the name suggests, a poly-A tail would be added with the help of polymerization activity. This was isolated from E. coli. It is a template independent enzyme because the polyadenylation is being performed in this. That is, for the 3' end labeling of RNA, we use this enzyme. These are the few MCQs pertaining to this lecture. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, aapki PPT WhatsApp.